Okay, so we're just about to begin an interview with Norm Mercer. It is December 1st, 2015. We are in St. John's, Newfoundland, and the interviewer, as usual, will be William Cripp. So, just to begin, could you please state your full name?
Yes, okay, so my full name is Norman Lloyd Mercer.
And your age?
My age, I'll be 62 this Friday, December the 4th.
Happy birthday.
Yes, thank you very much. And it's a beautiful, sunny, wintry day here
in
St. John's.
Yeah. And where were you born?
I was born on the Army side. I'm originally from Gander.
Okay.
So I was born on the Army side, which was located just near the airport, Gander Airport, in December 4th, 1953.
And what did your parents do when you were a child for a living?
Yes, okay, so, well, certainly my mother and father were both very active community members involved in many different organizations, and my father was the electrical supervisor for Gander International Airport with the Department of Transport, and prior to Confederation, he worked in Gander, and he worked with the Canadian Armed Forces there as a civilian electrical technician, and so my mother was a full-time mom and stay-at-home mother, and my father, as I say, worked with the Department of Transport, and our home in Gander was the 10th private dwelling built in the Newtown site in the early 50s, and so it, you know, for my first few months I moved in. And so we grew up on Metcalf Street, myself and my three brothers and my sister.
I live on Metcalf Street in Ottawa.
Yes, okay, yes, and all the streets, or just about all the streets in Gander, are named after famous aviators.
Okay.
Right? Oh, yes.
So what did you do as a child for fun? What were your go-to activities?
Well, and I've said this many times in many presentations to various groups, whether it be teachers or students, or prospectors and others, but just outside that window is the greatest outdoor classroom and laboratory in the world. It can never, with all the greatest minds, can never be duplicated inside four walls in a lab or a classroom. And so we were very much outdoor oriented. Our parents were very outdoor oriented. My mom was heavily involved, grew up in the Girl Guides in Twillingate. And so she was quite active in Girl Guides, and my sister got involved with that. We were quite active in all levels of scouting. My dad served on the group committee, wanting us to be exposed to other adults and to build those relationships and strengths in our characters. But as far as, so we were very outdoor oriented, so whether it was lots of street hockey, hockey on the pond, playing in the tall grass and imagining that we were various tribes of Indians and cowboys and so on, every type of adventure.
Yeah.
One of my favorite activities was lying down in the evening just after dark with my friends on a grassy field and looking up and imagining as far as the stars and the universe and all the opportunities.
Yeah, for sure. So yeah. Already into exploration, kind of.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And so in terms of, well, in our early years, and while my grandparents were alive in Bay Roberts, we would visit there during my father's summer holidays, or we would go to Twillingate. My mother's parents had passed away at earlier ages, but we would spend all kinds of time looking for little crabs or other creatures in the kelp beds just across the road from their home in Twillingate or in Bay Roberts, and then we would hike the hills and cliffs and crags and search for all kinds of glistening white quartz that we would take and gather, and other sparkly looking stones, or we would look for various types of flowers or types of plants, or in terms of wildlife in Twillingate. There were some foxes in the hills, and so we used to spend our days roaming the hills and just having all kinds of great fun and creating in our own minds various types of activities and events. In the evenings, it was spotlight, As I say, there was such a range of activities that, and trouting, fishing, fall of the year, picking berries with our parents, whether it was blueberries or partridge berries or marsh berries. As I say, our parents were very outdoor oriented, like most Newfoundlanders and Labradorians. And I guess what television only came in the early 50s, and we had two channels, CBC and CJON. But no, most, you know, we had the greatest, lab in the world, the greatest facility in the world, and that was the great outdoors. It was just, you know, our days were full. There was just one, and the same, like I say, in the early years in school, my mother just had one rule that supper would be at 5 o'clock. And as we got older in school, of course, we were involved in all kinds of extracurricular activities. But great interest I had, and my brothers had, in, again, collecting sparkling stones and minerals, particularly the white quartz, which we would then take a bag of it and go in a closet in one of our grandparents' homes, and with no light, and we would try to cause sparkles. and so we would spend much time at that.
And your interests at school, what were you, were there certain classes where you were really good or very interested in?
I loved history.
Okay.
I loved science. But most courses things, I really enjoyed, as far as all, you know, as I say, for our parents, as I say, I've often thought, and I always did over the years, just how the time in terms of, you know, with five children and all the various activities. And like I say, in the summers, like we would go camping all over Newfoundland and to the mainland, to Prince Edward Island, to Nova Scotia and New Brunswick. And we would go to various parks or various facilities and camp out, and we'd have sing songs and campfires. So, you know, it was a very, very active, wonderful upbringing.
So it's kind of like me for school, where you kind of liked everything.
Yes. So
what were your plans going into or starting to finish high school? What were your plans going to be for higher education?
Yes. So like I say, so the oldest in our family, my sister, she came into St. John's to do nursing at the old general and became a nurse in the province. And my oldest brother, well, like I say, he was building radios, I think, when he was 7 or 8 years old, or all kinds of electrical gadgets. He was a whiz and very disciplined, very, very, very bright. And so he went on to do engineering, electrical engineering here at Memorial. And it was only a 3-year program at that time, and you had to finish your degree in Atlantic Canada at Nova Scotia Technical College. So he went on there and did that and won the Governor General's medal for the highest marks. And even in school, he was all-rounded as far as scholastic, sports, editor of the school news, everything. And so for myself and my brothers, we were probably more outdoor-oriented. Myself and my brother, 1 year older than I, we both went on and did geology. My younger brother became a park naturalist. But in my, you know, when you look at grade 9, 10, 11, well, as I say, we grew up in scouting and in an outdoor family environment. So we had a group, grade 11, we had a group in Venturers at that time. And there was about 12 or 14 of us, and a number of people were going to do wildlife management. Several were going to do forestry. And several of us, my brother had gotten a summer job, so I would have been grade 11, and he would have been first year university. And Naranda Mines, Naranda Exploration, had just opened up an office in Gander and had several geologists and field crew there. That's where they came in contact with the Keatses, the well-known Keats family, Ted and Alan Keats, and their other brothers, who they grubstaked as prospectors. So my brother that summer got a job as a junior assistant with Naranda in their exploration programs in the province, coming over from New Brunswick. And so they were mostly focused on base metal, volcanogenic massosulfide type deposits. And so when he would come out of the field or various times when we chatted, you know, it just, as far as, because I always had that interest in rocks and minerals and the outdoors, and it just was, it was, I guess it's probably from the stories he told me and about his activities and exploits as far as in helicopters and in field camps and the type of work and searching for these types of deposits, that that kind of convinced me not to do forestry or wildlife management, but to pursue earth sciences and geology.
Okay.
Because in high school, we had physics and chemistry and biology, but we didn't have a formal geology course. Okay, and that was only available in certain schools in the province. It's mostly, if it's going to be amongst the sciences, many times the geology is considered the lesser of the major group of sciences, and that debate and discussion has been had many times.
Yeah,
they're all important sciences.
For sure.
Yes.
Sure. And so you graduated from geology?
Yes, I did 3 years at MUN. My mind and efforts weren't totally focused on the academic side, and I was quite heavily involved on the politics of the department, politics in general and history. I loved the outdoor, the field component and the labs and so on, but as far as formal classroom type settings, it wasn't for me. So I did 3 years. I had worked with Naranda, and I think they saw enough in me, people like Peter Dimmel and Ron Hawks and Bud James, that they kept me on, and I stayed out for, I guess it was over a year or more. My parents really encouraged me to, that you should really, at some point come back and finish your degree. I had, I had a good B average, and I enjoyed it. So I went back, but, I completed it, but really, as I say, I still wasn't scholastically focused, I guess. I'll put it that way. And
You did it just to finish it?
I did it, yes, honestly. Yeah. I did it just to finish it. Yeah, so I finished there and graduated 1975-76 with the Bachelor of Science in Geology.
And what would you consider your first real job to be afterwards?
There were several different potential jobs. Naranda had offered me a project geologist position in New Brunswick, which I graciously declined. I wanted to stay here in the province. I have, growing up in my family and our roots in Twillingate and Bay Roberts, and growing up in central Newfoundland, I had watched as several of my brothers had left and gone to the mainland. They could have picked up work here, but opportunities were more limited. But I did want to stay and to try to, pursue my interests here and to contribute. So in terms of the first real position that I got, yes, because I know it was Abitibi in Abitibi Price at that time. They were looking to interview for a position in the Grand Falls Buckens area, and there were several other positions that were part-time, but there was a position that was advertised for a geologist to work on the mineral occurrence data system with the provincial geological survey. So that was in around about 1977, and prior to that I had worked with one of their project geologists mapping in central Newfoundland for about 6 months. And so I came in, I drove in for an interview. Myself and my older uncle from Twillingate came in with me for a run and did the interview. We were going to stay overnight. And, as I say, I was more an outdoors type. So my uncle waited for me quietly and patiently in the car while I did the interview at the government building. And then we came out, we were going to get a hotel room and stay. But I looked at him after the interview and I said, "Do you really want to stay in St. John's tonight?" And he said, "Not really." And I said, "No, same here." So we headed back home. So that next day they called to say that I had successfully come first in the interview. So I started a 15-month contract within the mines branch, within the, now at that time it was, I think, the Mineral Development Division, but it was the Mineral Occurrence database system, and this of course was based on the national mineral inventory system that the federal government had and that the various provinces had tried to correlate their data with and integrate their data with within a computerized MODS database, mineral occurrence database. So I worked on that, and I worked on the Stephenville 12, NTS-12B mineral occurrence map sheet for Western Newfoundland, and also quite active with the division manager, along with the computer geologist they had, to develop the computer program for that. So that was about 15 months, and I suppose really sometimes it's being in the right place at the right time. And one of the other chaps who was there working with the Geological Survey, a chap by the name of Doug Fogwell, he had worked there as a mineral information geologist or exploration consultant, had chosen at that point to move on. And so that position came open, and it was advertised. And this was more or less in the early days, starting in the early 70s, there, mid-70s, of the pan-provincial and national mineral development agreements across the country, where the federal government and various federal governments committed significant dollars, and provinces put in their portions. But this was really the beginning of the development of a modern, well-staffed geological survey and mines branch within this province, and certainly within other provinces. Mm-hmm. So I applied for that position, which was a permanent position with the Provincial Geological Survey as mineral exploration or industry geologist, and I was successful in getting that. So I started that in, I think it was January of 1978, and I stayed in that position from there till, I guess, the spring of 2012, March 2012. Okay. And I love my work. It wasn't work. It was my hobby. And as I say, I interacted in a wide range and a diverse range of different responsibilities and activities, mostly focused, as I say, towards our prospectors and towards those within junior or mid-tier or major companies that were looking at Newfoundland and Labrador as a place to come and explore.
Were there any, throughout your career, are there any examples of project you worked on or were involved with that resulted in really fruitful findings that are worth mentioning?
Well, I guess in terms of, at that time there was an exploration association in the province, because we did have like companies like Naranda and Falconbridge and Inco and so on, along with, there wasn't many prospectors, independent prospectors who worked on their own. In the early parts of my career, in the 1970s and prior to that, in much of the last century, two-thirds of the last century, and even prior to that, the main mode of acquiring mineral rights in the province was called the concession system, where Newfoundland and Labrador didn't have a lot of developed infrastructure. The mapping was only regional at best. The geoscience database was sparse, and so to attract the large mainland companies to the province, or international companies with not a whole lot of road access, infrastructure, electrification and the mapping and so on, the mode was the concession system, which would be to offer the big carrot, which is to offer large tracts of land to these various companies to come in and to work over many, many years. And so they were long-term concessions over vast parts of our mineral rights. And that came to be known, and during our first half of Confederation, during the Smallwood years, that was a mode of land tenure that Joey Smallwood, and with advice from the advisors that he had, both within government and outside, that was the process by which investment was attracted to the mineral industry in this province. Was it unique or new? No. When we look at the history of Newfoundland and Labrador, it's always been the big carrot. And so this mindset of by successive governments of no more giveaways, it was a matter of large tracts of land or large tracts of rights in our province, whether it was to build the railway 100-odd years ago. And the island government, the colony, didn't have a lot of money, so they offered tracts of land. and they offered woods rights and so on and so on when the large mill was created in central Newfoundland, again by the Anglo-Newfoundland Development Company. They were given the water rights, the forestry rights, mineral rights, and there was a history of those related to many of the big projects. And one of the challenges was the length of these types of agreements and what appeared to be like significant requirements of work and economic activity. But over time, it was a matter of these companies did this work, but then especially as we got into the 60s, some of these areas kind of became stagnant. There wasn't a lot of activity, and the government started to look, and when we look in terms of within Canada, which has a modern mineral industry, and if we look at those provinces with significant and diverse mineral industries and commodity production, you see that they had a more competitive style of acquiring mineral rights. It showed in provinces like Ontario and Quebec, or in New Brunswick, or in Manitoba and British Columbia, where you saw in some of these bigger provinces multi-billion dollar industries, that some of the key cornerstones were, you know, competitive land tenure systems, a vibrant pool of prospectors and teams of prospectors that had a significant part to play, promoters, some juniors, and you go up, you know, from there to mid-tier to major companies. Mm-hmm. And so in this province, though we had those types of people in the early days of, particularly in the 1800s, but different governments over time basically moved more towards this business of the concession system. Of course, our early history was such when the early fishing admirals and the government from England would not allow any, they would allow temporary construction and habitation around the beaches and coves, but no permanent residency. And so, you know, we were very much a controlled country. Mm-hmm. And many of our rights, as I say, were issued out to a small number of players, some local, some in England, some in mainland Canada or the United States. And it was in the latter part of the second half, the latter part of the last century, when that started to change, you know, in terms of how we would move forward to develop a more modern, competitive land tenure system. So I guess for me, most of my efforts or work that I was involved in would be in terms of to assist and support and do what I could in my role to encourage and support the prospectors who started to come on the scene in the province. I spent considerable time within the CIM Newfoundland branch as a volunteer. I initiated the Mining Week initiatives in terms of public awareness and education in the early 1990s when the industry was at very much of a low, but I knew we had such tremendous potential. We are a people of a vast land mass, 500,000 people. We should be amongst the most wealthy, vibrant societies anywhere on the planet. And so why has that not happened? And there's a number of reasons for that. But we have such diverse resources in terms of, and I always, when I give talks to students and so on, that if we want to see our present or future, we have to look at that past. And we have to go right back to our geological history. We have to go right back to...
geologically, it's a very rich island.
Yes, I mean, it's a place where ancient continents collided. Uh-huh. It's one of those unique places because of its vast coastline and cliff exposures that you can basically see a full cross-section through an ancient mountain belt where two ancient continents collided and destroyed an ocean hundreds of millions of years ago, and capturing over 600 million years of Earth history. And then we look to Labrador, where some of the oldest rocks have been dated existing on the planet, over 4 billion years. Those types of events of continental collision, ocean destruction, and the tectonic upheaval, they repeated themselves many times. So What does that say is that we have vast mineral potential. Absolutely. And of course, in our offshore, you know, we, from the very earliest of explorers, you know, we are located along, adjacent to one of the great fishing baskets, one of the great food baskets of the world, in terms of within the Grand Banks of Newfoundland and Labrador, which were the debris that was shed from those ancient mountains as they eroded and were weathered down and flowed, those materials flowed towards the sea. And so we had such a diverse and vibrant fishery. And when you look at the monies that were made in whales or seals or all the vibrant life of the sea and the birds, and then when you look at a people that for the most part in the rural areas were destitute, then something is not right. And that was always my interest and my history and why I wanted to stay. And so I was taught that if we all can make it just a little bit better during our time and with opportunity, then we've done our part. And mm-hmm. So that's what I was guided by my two parents. They raised a family in a wonderful setting with nothing but love in that house. And my mother was a person of great faith, but she lived her faith. And both of them were very active and both in supportive of family, neighbors, and community. And so that whole mindset of giving back, I guess it's something that was instilled in me from a very early age. So I spent an awful lot of time on the volunteer side of things mm-hmm. in my community or within my profession. And so for me, I can't really look at one, you know, one particular project, because there were quite a number of yeah. projects. I supported prospectors and encouraged them wherever I could. I participated in the industry associations. This would be with amongst some of the industry players like a Peter Dimmel, some of these people who put time into these things to try to. To try to attract and secure further investments. So we applied and we got some funding from regional government programs to assist prospectors to go to shows like the Roundup in Vancouver to meet with many of the various companies and promoters there. Or we started the Atlantic Canada Rock Room. We teamed up with other players from New Brunswick and Nova Scotia to create the Atlantic Canada Rock Room, which was a showcase of the mineral resources, geology, and potential of the Appalachians in this part of northeastern Canada. And so, you know, the list goes on and on as far as the various types of projects.
Did you ever do a bit of prospecting on your own?
I always had an interest. I had a very supportive employer within my family. My oldest son has a disability, an intellectual disability. I also have two daughters, but many times for my son, who when he became old enough and joined Beavers, and we always believed in a totally inclusive setting for our son and to nurture and love him to the best of our abilities, and for him to realize the best that life can offer, realizing that for him there was a requirement for strong supports. And so when I was in scouting, I'm an honorary member of the Provincial Council of Scouting in this province after spending 30-odd years and nurtured, and I hope I passed on some positive qualities to hundreds of young people in my area. But when my son Stephen was old enough and went into Beavers, I went right back as a leader from Scouting and Venturers and went right back and then followed him through right through to Rovers. And so in terms of as Stephen got older, and he always enjoyed the outdoors and hiking, and I had an arrangement with the department, and this is how I would have my son out on the weekend, and we would go and we would visit with various prospectors, and if it was accessible sites, the department would give me a vehicle and a gas card, and I would give the prospectors my time and property visits. And I did that for years, all during my son's early teen and teen years on and through. So as far as to go and visit with prospectors and to try to give them some advice, some guidance, So the prospecting that I did was to assist them, to give them some tips and ideas. They got some further knowledge from someone who had a background in geology and that background in exploration. And so it was a win-win for me and my son. And it was those opportunities, because most of my work was related out of the office. So digging through a lot of the old data to find clues and tips of new information or historic information that could aid prospectors in various parts of the island or Labrador. So from those data sets and from those visits, were there showings or prospects that were followed up on or new discoveries made? Oh yes, many, many were made. Okay. But, you know, like I say, in terms of when I was with, when Voisey's Bay was discovered by Al Chislett and Chris Verbisky on a beautiful sunny fall afternoon in September of 1993. And they came back just a few weeks later from their finishing up their diamond work, diamond exploration in Labrador. They came to visit me in the office, as all the various prospectors did and still do at my home, and brought in their pack sack and asked if I had a bit of time to look at some samples. And they hauled out the first samples from a rusty gossan that they had located somewhere in Labrador. And they hadn't staked any claims at that time. At a place what later became known as Discovery Hill. So we had, as I had had hundreds of times, you know, throughout the years, I described the samples to the prospectors. I gave them a sense of the type of setting, the type of mineralization, and, you know, what possibly was economic within those samples. So I hope in some small way my advice, my guidance, whether it was in the field or whether it was in the office, help play a part to realize some value and some discovery for those people. Because that passion I have and that belief as a geologist with that science is that we have vast resources still untapped. We only have had a modern generation of prospectors really since the 1980s. And when we look at these other provinces and in terms of those building blocks that came together to realize vibrant multi-billion dollar mineral industries, we're only still in the early days of that of that effort.
Change topics a little bit, but more on the social side, but how absent or present were women in the workplace throughout your career?
Yeah, so it's something that, I mean, in the early years, well, I remember when I did geology, you know, and so the first couple of years, well, our second year class in geology, I think it was 42 young people from all over Newfoundland and Labrador and several from Atlantic Canada. Most all of them were males. I think there was either four or six females at that time. And over a period of time, I mean, and I've seen that over the years and through various initiatives, through more public awareness, through some very targeted affirmative action programs, we've seen that grow, and through a range of, I guess, policy decisions too, and program development, like women in resources and so on, or the outdoors for the woman. There's a number of different initiatives, now many years the class is probably 55% or 60% young female adults, or young females, right? Yeah, so it's changed dramatically. And that's the same across a number of the sciences. So one time what would be probably, it would be very, very odd to see actually a field geologist who was a woman. Yes, there might be someone who worked in the lab or in research at the university or at the office within offices within government. You see more and more now achieving the field side of the sector, and that's reflected now certainly within our own geological survey in this province or at the university, and I'm sure that's similar in many provinces across the country. Mm-hmm. When I went to school, and all of us as far as the baby boomers of the late 40s, 1950s, but I mean when I went to school in the mid 1950s and 60s, there were 150,000 school children, from kindergarten to grade 11 in this province. Today, there are 68,000. Mm. We have a very much an aging population. Most of us, as far as baby boomers, are like, you know, you're looking at late 50s into early 60s. I think it's something like 25 or 30% of our province's population will be beyond 65 within a few short years. But in terms of just when you look at the number of school children, and within that population, 52% are girls. So, I mean, you're talking less than 70,000. I remember when we used to do up rock and mineral kits, educational teaching kits for schools in this province back first when we were involved in it in the 1970s. And prior to that, Doug Fogwell and others were involved. But, I mean, there was something like almost 1,000 to 1,200 schools in this province. Back when Newfoundland and Labrador came into Confederation, there were close to 1,400 communities. Most of those communities were located on islands or coves or nooks or crannies close to the fishing grounds. That was our history. That was our development. And then over time, and certainly during Smallwood's centralization program of the 1960s, to bring in a lot of the small groups of people from some of these island communities, such that if you wanted to have, you know, proper road access, if you wanted to have good schools, if you wanted to have health care, for a place with such a large landmass and such a small population, there was just no way. And that's not just the history of ourselves. I think many rural areas of Canada and other places, you see a lot of those small farming towns or logging communities that would disappear.
And if you look also, especially with the aging population, if you look at all of Atlantic Canada, it's looking like that.
Yes,
if you look
exactly.
at my region, New Brunswick, it's very similar.
Exactly.
I mean, it's the same across the country.
Yes.
And most developed countries in the world, but especially in Atlantic Canada, it's going to be an issue.
Yes, no, exactly. And it's an issue. And you know, past governments and certainly for the present government, these are issues that are front and center in terms of where we're to. And my belief has always been, and going forward, that the that we have great potential for other discoveries. We have tremendous opportunities, whether it's within the mineral side, whether it's in oil and gas, whether it's in hydro and energy and so on. I remember when Albert and Chris went on and secured a two-year, they were the discoverers of Voisey's Bay as two of our local prospectors, one of the greatest mineral discoveries within North American history at a place called Voisey's Bay. And when they went on to secure a two-year exploration management contract to oversee the exploration and drilling at Voisey's Bay with Diamond Fields, you know, they put together a local team of people within their private company, Archean Resources. They asked me to step away from government for a year, which is something individuals can do. You can go back to university, you can travel, or you can go into the private sector for a year. And so I was manager of corporate affairs for Archean here in St. John's. And when you look at the, I used to meet fairly often with the Norwegians who were quite active here. And, you know, when you look at our landmass, when you look at our population base, as I say, we should be one of the wealthiest, richest peoples. And I don't mean just in money, okay? Because as I say, I have a son who has a disability. And poverty or impoverishment or lack of opportunity is more than just financial. It's a range of things, whether it's education, whether it's access to good quality work or good quality healthcare services and so on. And so, you know, we are a place that I did it up. And I remember saying to Albert and Chris, I said, you know, per capita, we're richer than the Kuwaitis. And so now why do we have a stagnant stubborn, you know, double-digit unemployment rate? And so again, we have to go back and look at, you know, our history, that development, and how we've gone about. And so one of our strongest things, and why, like, well, like say for Al Chislett and for myself and a number of others, why the Newfoundland and Labrador Party was formed was because of what became very well known, I guess, with Premier Brian Peckford in the early days of the offshore and the Atlantic Accord, and if you look at under Premier Danny Williams, as far as no more giveaways, you know, that that the discovery and those commodities, which are of such value to our societies because you know, we utilize the products of minerals, and that's growing every year at 2 or 3%, even though there's a big downturn right now. The old adage was, if it can't be grown, it has to be mined. We're doing this today using the products developed from minerals, or we wouldn't have these technologies.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you just on that that good quote right there. I'll ask you the question. Do you think there is a disconnect between the general population and the natural resource world or these industries?
Yes, like I say, in terms of it, there's a huge disconnect, and there's been efforts that have made. I think that they need to be more collaborative across the country. There have been instances of that. As I say, back in 1990, and that was a time when our industry was in one of those cyclical lows. Several of the mines in the province had either exhausted their resources or reserves, or markets were down and mines closed, or say, like in the instance of our asbestos mine, of course, there was the whole health and safety issues around of mining of asbestos and so on. And so it was a very low time within the industry, but I rolled up my sleeves, and I was only one of a number of people, both within the department, the mines branch, and some from industry. We rolled up our sleeves, and I chaired the first Mining Week initiative, which was to highlight and promote our mineral industry, its present state of affairs, but in terms of also the whole business of for students and for the general public to realize that it is the products of minerals that are all around us. And so we kicked off, and of course a number of provinces were working on these things. Eventually there was a national mining week. So different provinces have done different things. I know our people have teamed up, and when I say our people, I mean through the mines branch and the geological survey. There was an outreach public education geologist position there over the past few years, that the young geologist who was involved there, who had good science as a background, who had teaching experience, who had outreach experience through the Geo Center, and she initiated, Amanda McCullum, she initiated a number of initiatives, which was to upgrade and modernize the rock and mineral kit, rock and mineral kit resources, and to make them totally compatible with curriculum outcomes in the school system. Because for teachers and for academics, I mean, if you can just, you know, reach off shelf for these resources being developed in a very, you know, dynamic and stressful education setting today, so that these products are there and they could just incorporate them right within their lesson plans, whether it was in grade 4 or grade 7 or in the earth resources courses of high school, then this would be that much the better. So public outreach and education, I remember going to Halifax many years ago, and a lot of this was during one of the mines ministers conferences. And I was surprised, I was asked, but I appreciated, because I was education chair for the local chapter or local branch of CIM. And so this was to talk Mining Week and to talk about the various initiatives. And I mean, around that table, under that particular subset topic, which was going to be on public awareness and education, you know, you had like the corporate affairs director for tech and the corporate affairs director for INCO, and on around, and also oil and gas, because these industries cross over with energy mines and resources, Canada, and the natural resources. And I said, ladies and gentlemen, if we just go around the table, just what's your budget? 12 million a year, 8 million, 6. I said, just add up, you know, the resources. And I said, so there's something not working, you know, with regards to, it's not a matter of access to financial resources or human resources. Where's the disconnect? So let's look at this. Let's start looking at some of these things. And some of this required bringing in those who could gather that kind of information for us. But I mean, you know, the credibility rating of many of the CEOs at that time in the 70s and 80s, 90s, was at a very low level. So if you're pitching your industry, and so you put out there, and it could be the finest kind of, most of them were men within the corporate world, there was a complete disconnect. I mean, it's a matter in some areas. There's good working relationships between, and we also, like I say, during our Mining Week initiatives, we reached out to the unions. Everybody's got to be part of the fix. And so, and there's been, you know, there's been some good work. It's multi-generational. It's not something that's going to change, you know, within a few years. It's going to take a lot of time. And as more and more of the populations become urbanized and or less removed from those resource-producing sectors, you know, then it becomes an even bigger challenge. But the resources are there. They're somewhat disjointed. And PDAC and CIM, I mean, a number of them have done a lot of good work, but there needs to be a lot more done. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we pick at it as volunteers within our local Prospectors Association, and we worked at it within CIM and a number of us with government and government supported. I mean, remember the first Mining Week we did, and Premier Clyde Wills agreed, along with our minister, Rex Gibbons, and so we had them out at the pyrophyllite mine to promote the pyrophyllite mine and pyrophyllite and its uses. And so, but these are, just like the environmental movement, all these things didn't happen, you know, and the greatest resource that we have is the people in this industry. Beyond the boardrooms, beyond the management, and some of these are very vital and important, but it's the average individual that works in those, you know, in those mines. And forestry learnt that in terms of how they went about education many years ago. Mining has learnt some aspects of it. There's a lot of good things that are going on, but there's a lot more to be done because of that whole challenge of, you know, one of the great submarine mines of the world is just a few minutes beyond here at Belle Island, one of the great iron ore mines of the world, operated there for much of the last century. And thousands of people worked there. And this city right here, this community, and many of the business people in this community gained great, you know, wealth from the paychecks of those miners. It's like out in central Newfoundland with the Grand Falls, Windsor, the pulp and paper mill. And then, of course, at Buchans, you had the discovery by one of our native sons, Matty Mitchell, of the great Buchans deposits, one of the, you know, highest grade polymetallic VMS systems in the world. And that was under the old Anglo-Newfoundland Development Charter of those concessions. That was, and then when A&D got a Sarco in there, because they were having troubles in the early days with the metallurgy to make the Buchans mines commercially viable. It was a co-tenancy, a 50-50% arrangement. So there were times when the pulp and paper was, prices were down, that it was their 50% of the profits that came from Buchans that helped maintain Grand Falls, yeah, Windsor. And so those things, those stories, those those connections, just this past summer, you know, we had a number of our members go on mine tours to the Beaverton Peninsula, which is one of our most historic and modern mining areas in the province. And so a number of our members went on mine tours to the Rambler Copper Gold Mine and to the Anaconda's Pine Cove Open Pit Gold Mine, along with the Nugget Pond Mill. And then they went to the historic mining community of Tilt Cove, which over 100 years ago was the second largest community in this province, second only to St. John's. Belle Island, of course. I mean, there used to be 12 to 14,000 people who lived there, right, before those mines closed. And there's still billions of tons of iron ore out under Conception Bay. You had fishermen for almost a century hauling cod traps while miners several hundred meters under the seafloor mined the iron ore. But that was an important process there this past summer, where as they interacted with the staff and the passion and the pride that they have in those workplaces, and that's the same in every profession. I mean, once you expose the public again, whether it's students or adults, you know, to the people that work in these industries, then you put the human face to it and you start to come to understand the different aspects of it, the safety side of things, the health, you know, and so on, and their economic importance and how that sector has sustained many communities, you know, throughout the province and across the country. So every place has done different things. what I said to the president of the PDAC, like several of the large organizations have, you know, they have very healthy bank balance. We're a small organization. We can do an awful lot with the passion and volunteerism, but in some instances you need access to some funds. And they teamed up, as I say, the province with the PDAC and with Mining Matters, and they delivered those programs in the Northern Inuit communities and also in the Inuit communities several years ago. So the disconnect is there. There's efforts that are being made, but again, it's not enough. There's still a lot more needs to be done. Back, I guess, what was it, in the 1980s, part of Memorial University, and Memorial had as many of these small communities because of their history, and because, as I say, for much of our first 150 to 200 years, permanent habitation and community development was illegal, you know, in terms of the control that the British fishing admirals and some of the merchants had over the peoples. But within Memorial University, and they used to say, like, what was Smallwood's one of his greatest accomplishments? And as far as, well, Confederation, of course, was a tremendous benefit. And the vast majority of Newfoundlanders and Labradorians are very proud Canadians. I mean, you know, that's, you know, is there a passion for that independence amongst some? Yes, amongst some. But I know when we started the Newfoundland and Labrador Party, that wasn't about nationalism or separation. That was about resources that we have, and us not only just mining it or cutting it down or jigging the fish with a jigger or a trawl and sending it away on process, but it was to secure the secondary or tertiary levels of benefits from these world-class assets. And that's always a tug of war in various jurisdictions. So it wasn't about it wasn't about you know, I grew up a Canadian and proud of it, but I believe that Newfoundland and Labrador can be a net contributor to Canada and like all areas, and so that was that's my interest and my belief that's kind of guided me throughout my adult life.
Mm-hmm. You might have mentioned a few, but this sounds like a mouthful of a question, but in your opinion, are there any events, people, inventions, discoveries, disasters, anything really that you deem important enough to mention when talking about the history of the natural resources in Canada?
Yes, yeah, certainly in terms, and just to finish on the other, one of the other initiatives that we had, which I was talking about the university, they had a tremendous community development extension service arm, which put professional people, sociologists, a range of professions out at the disposal of a number of these communities to build community capacity. And so in terms of one of the initiatives within Memorial University's extension service was to develop a series of resource camps for students and teachers. And within that, okay, so they may have developed like forestry camps, right? But they brought in, we developed, and we were very active in that, mining and exploration science camps, which took kids from non-mining areas and exposed them along with their teachers to prospecting in the field, to mineral exploration, to diamond drilling, to see the environmental footprint, the regulatory side, right up to mining. And those went on for a number of years, but that's the biggest challenge, right? It's having that needle and thread to bring it, weave it all together, and that it's a continuum. And that's the concern I have, because it's something that you have to continually be putting efforts into, because it's a multi-generational and a society change that's happening, and kids more and more aren't, you know, they're more to technologies than they are in the greatest technology, and still so many discoveries to be made out there in the natural environment, right? Will it come back to that? I think it will over time, but it's going to take a lot of people, a lot of organizations and government and to make that happen. Mm-hmm. So then, where were we? That was, I just finished up on one. But anyway, you had asked about the...
If you had, because you had mentioned a few discoveries and things like that, but if you had other, anything really whatsoever that you deem important to mention when talking about the history of the natural resources in Canada, whether it's a specific person, whether it's a specific discovery or a disaster, we can think of, for example, the Ocean Ranger for this area.
No, for sure.
Which was big. Yeah. If in the long term, anything that comes to mind that you think changed the natural resources or mining or geology.
Yeah, I think in terms of for this province and in terms of because I know it's always was a challenge in terms of when we would interact. And when I say we, whether that was within the not-for-profit organizations or whether that was with government, and when you were dealing, like say, with the Department of Education or others, in terms of to ensure that what was there was modern and present day and relevant, acknowledge things from, like, you know, our sense and feel for and understanding the environment, that's something that's grown over time, through a range of initiatives and programs and efforts by individuals. But things like the St. Lawrence forest fire mines, which the local people down there, you know, as they say, you had most people in rural communities in this province that were living a sustenance lifestyle. You know, like my parents would tell me from Twillingate, well, my uncle would say to me, and he lived to be well into his 90s, but, you know, prior to Confederation and really prior to the war, but during the Depression. And I mean, Newfoundland went through a period of time where it gave up its own government and allowed a commission of government made up of representatives from England and some from here to manage the affairs of the country, because the country, through political mismanagement, thievery, and just poor policy and management, was broke. But my uncle used to say to me, and they were, as they say, grew up in a newspaper family. There was no big money, because, I mean, a chap might come in and give them a bag of turnips and carrots for to put an ad in the paper, or a chicken, or a few fish, or whatever. But they always, their mom was a teacher, you know, young lady who was a teacher, and of course, the father was a newspaper man. But they, before he sat down to have his supper in the evening, he had to take three or four meals around to different people, and he said, you know, Norm, those people were starving. Like people, like this was a, you know, and this wasn't the only, like when Tommy Douglas them in the, you know, in the prairies and so on. And a lot of people, education was only for those who were well off. And very few, as I say, my mother was one of the only ones to get grade 11 on Twillingate Island. And Twillingate was a very vibrant community. Now everything was by sail and motorboat, before the motors, but it was all by sail. Twillingate is Portuguese for City of the North. It had a hospital. It had, everything was centered around your, you know, with the church and school and family and enterprise. But these were vibrant communities. Next door to my mother and my uncle was one of the great opera singers of the world, a prime Madonna opera singer, who had her own animals and vegetables. And she was one of the great opera singers in Europe and in the United States, Georgina Sterling. And So the culture produced tremendous people, right? And it developed a tremendous a character within our province, within that era. But where am I going? I've lost my train of thought. Forgive me. What was it we were talking
about?
oh yes, significant things. Yes. That was the backdrop for like St. Lawrence. I mean, if there was a potential for a mining venture. Well, I mean, the people, I mean, they helped. Well, I think it was some samples of the high-grade fluorspar that were sent to New York for testing. And I think it was a New York businessman who came there and put together the investments to build the St. Florence fluorspar mines. But, several generations worked, a full-time job working underground or above ground in a mine. As they say, I mean, nobody made big wages, but again, it was still much more than what the fishery was providing for them, which could be, you know, one year could be good with the cod fishery, another year it could be bad. But the long-term effects of miners underground blasting rock that contain low levels of uranium within the St. Lawrence granite, which through which these veins were created, the exposure there. And so if you go to St. Lawrence, where you had men of 30 and 40 who developed all kinds of cancers and died, you know, you'd look at people and you say, okay, well now this gentleman is the father and he's the son, but it wasn't that way. You know, there were dozens and dozens and several hundreds miners who died working underground in those mines because of the low levels of radiation. Now in more modern, you know, and a lot of that wasn't tested for, you know, and so on, and health and safety wasn't the same focus. And some of these industrial diseases take long times. So we had a history of several of those. So that was kind of there and the backdrop and part of the culture, or at least people's general sense of working in a mine. Because mm-hmm. like in Bayvert, well, it was the asbestos. It's like in Iron Ore Company of Canada, or like it was with silica dust within the iron ores and so on. So for a lot of the people who lived in St. John's or in other areas, they saw that it was, a dirty, probably unhealthy, and that kind of, so, because I remember when I came into earth sciences, to do geology, that was kind of the mindsets that were there. And if you looked at what was there in social studies and geography, and within the textbooks of the schools of the 60s, 70s, into the 80s. A lot of it dwelt on those types of, these things happened, but those sorts of negativities persisted even after with other people who came and reopened the mine, which people would still flock to. Mm-hmm. But they brought in modern ventilation. You know, if you had proper ventilation, you could reduce the risk. It's like out in at the asbestos mine in Bayvert, they brought in programs and campaigns to get chaps to stop smoking, to wear the various masks and so on, right? Some of these industrial diseases take long times to. Mm-hmm. So that was the sense I know in late 70s into the 80s that our textbooks, and there was, you know, within our culture community or arts community or in books, I mean, there were books written, you know, on the St. Lawrence tragedy, or books written on the early days at Belle Island, or the Buchan's miners, you know, and so on. So I think, you know, a mindset, and a lot of it true, that, you know, it was a really dirty, you know, unsafe work setting. And that's what I see, because a couple of the most significant things in my mind were, well, for Newfoundland and Labrador, the change of the concession system to bring in a modern competitive claim staking system was one of the most progressive, significant policies, legislative policies enacted by the government in the early 70s. And that was after the Smallwood era, when the Moores government came in, and then further on. And then they brought in a prospector training and prospector assistance program. And the first because as I say, the few prospectors that we did have, and there was very few of them as far as independence, they worked with the bigger companies, whether it was with Naranda or Brennix mm-hmm. or whoever, right? But to me, one of the most significant, which started to lay the groundwork for a future prosperous industry, was the breaking of the concession system. And they did it by consulting, by looking at legislation across the country. Many of the big Canadian companies, because like during the latter years with Smallwood, I mean, there were a number of people that were associated with them, or a few small companies, and they controlled most all of it. And so over a period of time, what the government chose to do on these large concessions or old fee simple mining grants, they brought in a graduated tax system. If you did exploration, they wanted to see more exploration. Mm-hmm. And also they wanted to see, you know, more of the concession coming open for claim staking, similar to how it was done in many of the provinces in Canada. And so they brought in a mineral impost tax legislation, which was a graduated tax. You had to pay so much per acre in tax per year. But if you did exploration, you could write that off against the tax. So the intent was to try to get more exploration activity, more discovery, and the same with more lands coming open. And so over a period of years, the mineral impost tax legislation and the new Mineral Act brought that about. We went from a place of over 90-odd% of the mineral rights vested in the hands of a few to 90-odd% of our mineral rights vested in the hands of all of us. Mm-hmm. And then you could go and gain title. But then they also, one of the things they did was to lands are coming open. And as I say, a competitive land tenure system is one building block, right? I believe that was one of the most significant events in our province's mineral industry and our history. And in terms of then another was that they started to offer small prospector grants, and they brought in a prospector training program. Larry was involved in that for years. Myself and one of the other geologists, several of the geologists there, we lobbied to put that together back in the many a late night, back in the 1970s, early 80s, to create a prospector training program.
Yeah, he was talking, Larry Hicks gave it for 23 years or something.
Exactly,
it's
yes.
It's 2 weeks.
It's the two-week course, and we're certainly working right now on several shorter introductory-type courses. We just finished the other day, like our association, we want to partner with the, like the Nunatsiavut government, that's the Inuit self-government in northern Labrador, which was all part of the land claim settlement related to the Voisey's Bay discovery, which brought about that, accelerated that land claim happening. We're looking at partnering with them to develop a 5-day introductory prospector course for Inuit members, and it's all been put together, and now they're just shopping around within the Nunatsiavut government and also within other potential federal or provincial sources to host that particular course. And they also had prospector grants. So the minister of the day, so this is why as far as the several of the significant other events would have been, when we went to school, the mindset and our history was that in terms of precious metals in this province, gold and silver, gold in particular, we didn't have a history of discovery, development, and mining of gold or of silver per se. We did have gold and silver production, but most of that were byproducts, secondary products, valuable products within a number of the base metal and polymetallic mines, such as at Buchan's in central Newfoundland, and as far as at Tilt Cove historically, and Rambler and so on in Notre Dame Bay. And it was in the fall of 1983, and that was at a time when all the oil companies, somewhere in the late 70s, they decided that they were going to diversify into further resource areas, and they all created like minerals arms. Like there was Amoco Minerals, Hudson's Bay Oil and Gas Minerals Division, British Petroleum, and they had Selco. And you go on through the list, Chevron, Shell, they had, a lot of them were into uranium, other energy sources, but they also got into particularly base metals. So it was in the fall of 1983 that BP Selco, and this was after some lands had come open, but this was the discovery of the Hope Brook gold deposit in 1983-84 in the south, on the southwest coast of Newfoundland. And that was the first significant, you know, gold deposit discovered, one of the largest in the Appalachians. You'd have to go to the Carolinas and to Hale and Ridgway and so on in the Carolinas to see these type deposits, these what are called high sulfidation epithermal gold deposits. And that sparked an awakening of potential for gold standalone or gold silver deposits in the northeastern Appalachians, in Newfoundland and Labrador. And it set about a lot of staking and exploration activity all over the province within what were considered to be a number of different terrains of different ages, both on both sides of that ancient ocean and in various geological terrains. That would be one of the, in my time, one of the most significant discoveries. The discovery of Hope Brook in September of 1983. And this was, I remember, at the PDAC when Colin McKenzie, who was the exploration manager for BP Selco, you know, gave the presentation there on the discovery and its potential. They outlined close to 2 million ounces of gold with a cutoff grade of 2 grams. BP Selco developed a modern open pit, then to go underground mining operation on the southwest coast. Hundreds of millions of dollars flowed in there, and many millions of dollars were spent in staking and exploration in other parts of the province. And as I say, because when we were in school, and the mindset was that, well, you know, the Appalachians, in many instances, they're too deeply eroded, okay? And you're more down into the roots of this mountain system, ancient mountain belt. Mm-hmm. But as more and more mapping and science and discovery has been made, we see now that within the Appalachian terrain of northeastern Canada, the Atlantic region of Newfoundland, that in a number of instances, in places, the ancient surface is only shallowly eroded. And we're seeing that because we're seeing other types of deposits that form in the upper parts of the ancient crust. So that really awakened Newfoundland and Labrador's fires for potential for gold.
Yeah.
And they developed a modern mine there. They operated it for a number of years. Gold prices dropped. They eventually sold it to Peggy Whitty and Royal Oak Gold Mines, who operated it for a number of other years. In this new gold cycle, the company has been down there, Coastal Gold, and they've outlined, you know, again, over 1 million ounces there. But all of the facility was removed from it after the mine wound down during the last cycle. And so that would be a significant event. Mm-hmm. And also, shortly after that, the timing was almost perfect, because that was at a time when the federal government started to bring in the flow-through exploration tax credit measures. Took a while for the industry and investors and brokerage firms to get a handle on it, but very soon, within a couple of years, you were seeing hundreds of millions of dollars of new investment dollars coming in, because the high-end investor who would put in a few thousand would get a tax credit, a tax break. And I mean, that federal initiative, which several provinces built onto, generated several billions of dollars into the exploration sector in Canada. And a lot of that money found its way into Newfoundland and Labrador, particularly on the island. And you started to see, like, Noranda Exploration, who had a large office in, well, they were in Central, they were here, they were in Cornerbrook, but they really got involved with a number of junior companies, and millions of dollars were spent. The prospectors they had, and others, numerous gold showings and prospects were discovered. The gold deposits of the Bayvert, the peninsula, were discovered later in the 80s during that flow-through push. But it was the Hope Brook discovery, okay, which put the island of Newfoundland at that time on the map as a place where, you know, standalone economic gold deposits could be discovered. Okay. And I remember Colin gave the talk, and the auditorium at the Royal York, there was blocked, and because it was a major. And this was, of course, shortly after the great Hemlo find in Ontario, and because that had its impact across the country. And I remember back then we were in one of the salons in the Royal York, and so Newfoundland and Labrador had a booth, New Brunswick had a booth, Nova Scotia had a booth, and we're all really in the same geological terrain, right? And it was a number of years later when we teamed up to form the Atlantic Canada promotional effort. And but at the booth after the talk, it was like, you know, there were maps and open files and reports. Okay. And it was just, you know,
brought everybody together.
It brought a lot of excitement and interest in the gold potential of Newfoundland and Labrador, because we did have a couple of small gold prospects or deposits, but, you know, maybe several hundred ounces had been produced, you know, late in the late 1700s or 1800s or at the turn of the century, but not a lot. Most of it was like at a place called, you know, at Buchan's or at Tilt Cove and Rambler,
as secondary metals.
Yes, yeah. Exactly, right? Yeah. And then, of course, well, you know, when you look at, I mean, there are many great discoveries and great mines that this province has had, but the Buchan's discovery, by Matty Mitchell when he led the team of Anglo-Newfoundland Development, the A&D company, surveyors and geologists on a place on a river that flowed into a lake called Red Indian Lake. And generally south of Red Indian, it was kind of like Mi'kmaq territory, and Red Indian and north and northeast was Beothuk country. But Matty Mitchell led the team of individuals to a place on the river where he had seen the glistening metals. And this was the Buchan's River discovery. And of course, that went on. Matty Mitchell is credited as the prospector. We named our Matty Mitchell Prospector Resources Room, that we developed at the department. That I consider a major accomplishment. Myself and another geologist generated that a number of years ago. And that serviced and supported prospectors in this province and a number of the exploration companies for the last, 17 or 18 years now. But Matty Mitchell's, the discovery of Buchan's, of course, that has been, that's long lived also, right? Because that was amongst the highest grade polymetallic zinc, lead, copper, gold, and silver deposits of their types in a volcanic island arc setting to be found anywhere in the world. And those mines operated for well over 60 years by ASARCO, and there's still exploration there. It brought numerous large companies in, smaller companies and prospectors into that area. And that was one of our, that discovery occurred in 1905. So we started, we have a presentation that we wanted to make to our association, we wanted to make to the three political parties on steps that they could take, modest steps, modest investments, to reignite the exploration and prospecting sector in the province, which is facing the same malaise as a number of the areas across Canada. And part of that starts off with how in the last century, the century began with a great world-class discovery. And during the latter years of that century, it ended with another world-class prospecting discovery, the discovery of Voisey's Bay. And so Larry and Emily talked to you about the course.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But back in the late 80s, early 1990, the government brought in these small, modest prospector grants. And as I say, the prospector course, which now to develop, you know, that new generation of prospectors that we had, which came together in the late 80s, early 90s, and on as we go forward. And minister at the of the time in the Brian Peckford Progressive Conservative government, his name was Jerry Dinn, and he thought it was a significant event. We had started the prospector training course, and the co-discoverer of Voisey's Bay, Christopher Biskey, used to assist Larry Hicks there in showing some of the participants how to pan and so on.
Okay.
Chris grew up in an exploration mining family where his father worked at Buchan's, and this gentleman here, who got an interest in prospecting, he has a background in a small construction company and in finance with accounting diplomas. But this gentleman right here, Al Chislett, he gained an interest in prospecting by hearing about it. He loved the outdoors, and he has a passion to be successful in whatever he does. And on a particular Friday, this day, I remember the secretary, this gentleman came in, and he said, "Would Norman Mercer be available to see me?" And so she came down and she said, "Norm, there's a gentleman here from the Goulds, just outside of St. John's, and his name is Albert Chislett. He'd like to meet with you." So he came in, and he sat down, and we talked all about prospecting. We talked about the prospector training. We talked about different aspects of our potential. He realized I had a lot of enthusiasm and passion. He had an intensity about him. And I remember after about an hour, and he wanted to start looking on the Avalon Peninsula. And so he started. Now I said, "Don't get intimidated, you know, by the maps and the words that I'm going to, the reports I'm going to give you." But I said, "Just think about it as natural processes." And so he went on. I think within a week he had found his first showing. But I remember when he left the office that day, and it was a quiet intensity, right? When he left that day, I said to the chap that worked with me as an information officer, I said, "You know, if ever I met a man who will find a mine, I met that man today." I told him about that the other day, because from that day, He would call me probably two or three times a week or visit, but then he'd visit with the Naranda geologists or prospectors and so on. So in late 1980s, early 1990, they were just bringing out a program, $100,000, and they would issue out small prospectors grants up to, I think, it was $3,000 to $5,000 to assist with their gas, cost of their assays, a bit of food, and so on. The first grant, they said, could you touch base and get Mr. Chislett to come in? And so Minister Din presented Al Chislett with a check for, I think it was $3,000 or $4,000. That was in late 80s, 1990. And just three short years later, right, on September 9th, they land at a place called Voisey's Bay. And they returned to this province a multi-billion dollar venture. The Voisey's Bay mine alone has contributed just in direct mining and mineral rights tax over $1 billion to the treasury of this province since 2006. Just that one mine, right? And the other new mines. So this is all part of our pitch to the, that was a very modest investment, $100,000 that are dished out to individuals around the province who were getting involved in prospecting. And in those mineral development agreements of the 70s and 80s and 90s, the approach would be, and people like John Fleming or Brian Green and Paul Dean and these, they, in the planning and management and execution of these joint federal-provincial agreements for the island, looking at the size landmass, that if they could achieve over multiple five-year mineral development agreements to map the island on a 1 to 50,000 scale, and for Labrador, 1 to 100,000. So as they say, it's it hasn't been that long,
yeah.
You know, in terms of for those initiatives. So Buchans, of course, the discovery by Matty Mitchell. He was the most name in prospecting within the mineral industry in the province, because of the richness of those mines and their longevity. And we named the Matty Mitchell Prospector Resources Room, of course, after him. We had his descendants come in, and the minister at the time was Roger Grimes, who went on to become premier, to officially open the, it's just a modest facility, but it's got quite a large rock and mineral exhibit there, resource materials. There's a geologist there. It's a joint industry government initiative. The geologist who's there is actually paid by the Mining Industry Association. And it's something myself and the other geologist was Sean O'Brien. We advanced a proposal to develop, because they do a two-week prospector course, and you're bringing together a lot of people who have a lot of backgrounds. Some could have been fishermen. There could have been professional people, doctors, teachers. There could be skilled tradespeople. But for many of them, exposure to earth science, prospecting, or geology, for most of them, this is the first time. Everybody, tremendous course. The amount of information and methodology and techniques, it's a lot. And I remember one old chap said, because in more recent years, it was more retired people doing it, because of our demographics, right? But one gentleman said, he wasn't one of the older ones, but he said, you know, Norm, he said, that course, he said, is great. It's fantastic. For those 12 to 14 days, the lab work, the fields and the field trips, and Larry's excellent and the others, but they said, like, the amount of information and to try to retain it, it's like trying to get a glass of water from an open fire hydrant, as far as the amount of information. Yeah. And so part of the reason for developing the Matty Mitchell Room was to be that support facility that prospectors could come to, could email, could phone, could drop in and visit, to refresh themselves on some of that, or to gain new insights, right?
Okay.
Because you just can't do a course and let them sink or swim.
Yeah, for sure.
But anyway, so those would be the ones in terms
those are good examples.
Yes, and then of course Voisey's Bay, which would, you know, when Albert and Chris first came in and we went over it on that beautiful fall evening, and they hauled out the first samples and they were sitting there, and they said, Norm, you know, what type of rock do you think it is? Because like nickel sulfide ores, magmatic sulfide ores like Sudbury or Norilsk or the big ones or Manitoba, you know, this wasn't something that was common to our history in exploration and mining, like volcanic massive sulfide deposits and rusty gossans. Yes, And so the rusty gossan, but I said, you know, from what I could see, like the samples they showed me were well mineralized samples. And I said, you know, I said, in terms of rock type, I said, looks to me like a gabbro. I said, an iron magnesium rich, you know, dark colored intrusion. I said, that would have been a magma plume coming up through the ancient Earth's crust, and it would have crystallized many kilometers below the Earth's crust. And I said, so you're looking at, you know, what appears to be magmatic sulfides in an intrusive setting. And so they said, Norm, so, and the streaks of chalcopyrite, you know, which is a copper iron sulfide, I said, you're probably looking at about, you know, a 2%. Because first when they landed there after spotting the gossan from following up on their panning and their test sieving work for diamond indicator minerals, and that all came about again as a result of Chuck Fipke's discovery, right? When the millions of claims were staked all over northern Canada and in ancient Archean rocks and so on. But so that was their focus. When they went there, they didn't have the most up-to-date geology map for the Voisey's Bay area. So when they were finishing up their river sampling and heading back to the Inuit community of Nain, and as they came up and the sun kind of hit across that ridge and they saw this rusty orange glow, and Albert said to Chris, he said, look, you know, look, Chris, there's a gossan. And the helicopter, because they motioned to the helicopter pilot to take them over. And he said, guys, look, we got very little fuel left. It was at the end of the day. And he said, really, I just got enough to get back to Nain. So they just put a little X on their topo map.
Yeah.
And they went on to,
come back.
And then several days later, they still had several samples to get in the rivers there. So they came back. And they landed on Discovery Hill, and Albert said to me, he said, you know, Norm, in all that summer, because it was diamonds which was the deal they made with diamond fields to get them in there. But as two astute prospectors, if they, as they had two helicopters and two crews, one in each, right, going from stream and river to do these samples, but if they crossed over an area of quartz veins, they'd land, jump out, grab a sample for precious metals. If they saw a rusty gossan, they'd land, grab a sample. And I remember Albert saying to me, he said, you know, Norm, in all that summer of 1993, he said, there's only one place where myself or Chris motioned back to the helicopter pilot to cut her off. And that was at a place called Discovery Hill. They landed on that gossan and in a few minutes started chipping and seeing glistening of metal. And so what they thought first they were on was a very rich copper deposit. And they followed out the gossan, which goes off to the west and then falls out over Reed Book. You can see it on Google, right? And you can see how it's about 30 meters wide and it dips at about 80 degrees to the north, this zone, okay? So Chris wrote in his field book that day, I remember he showed it to me the year I was working with them, and that they measured it out. And so they felt that they were on a deposit of some 30 odd million tons of 2% copper. So anyway, when we were going through the samples, and I could see lots of pyrrhotite, iron sulfide, and there was lots of blebs there, like the measles magnetite. And I said, you know, but I said, and it's funny, because I had a corner office there in the Eastern Canada building, and the sun came across around the window. And I remembered the pentlandite samples that Dr. Papazic, Steve Papazic, he was a Czechoslovakian mineralogist who worked at MUN. He got out of Czechoslovakia after the Russians went in, right? Well, in fact, he had come over before that, but before it entered under a communist regime. But he was a tremendous mineralogist, and he had a fantastic collection from the beautiful, you know, museum-quality samples from around the world. But he had a couple of real nice pentlandite samples from Sudbury. And I remember the sun coming around, and I was saying, and I said, you know, guys, I said, Albert, I said, Chris, you know, I said, I can see another economic mineral here with the chalcopyrite. And Chris kind of, you know, and Albert kind of, what was that you said, Norm? I said, I can see another mineral. And I said, I can see a mineral. I said, it's pentlandite. Pentlandite? I said, yes, I said. I said, guys, you've got nickel. And I said, there's quite a lot of it there. So anyway, that excited them. And then they quietly packed up the bags and left, and then they wanted to go and talk with Bruce Ryan, who was our geologist who had mapped the region. And they did not stake a claim, right? They did not stake a claim to one of the world's great discoveries any time that fall of 1993, and it was early in the winter when they laid out the 200-odd claims over the footprint of Voisey's Bay, which is probably a resource value of some $50 billion, right? You know, at Voisey's Bay. And, but anyway, that's the story. That was in Jackie McNish's book, the lady from the Globe and Mail, the business reporter,
okay,
who wrote the book called The Big Score. I was corporate affairs manager then for Archaea, and so she used to call me and pose questions, and I would vet them by Chris and Albert, and so she'd always run titles by me, right?
Okay.
And she'd say, Norm, she said, you know, I'm thinking, and Friedland, I got Friedland to come back. He went on after that, of course, like Voisey's Bay made Robert Friedland the international financier and co-owner of Diamond Fields. That made him a billionaire. It made Albert and Chris two of the wealthiest Canadians in, you know, in the country. Their royalty was at a valuation of about $300 million, right? Which they sold a small portion to Altius, created a strong junior company, several other young geologists. And then they sold the remaining 2.66% to International Royalties for $180 million in cash and millions of shares. Plus, they also had millions of shares in Diamond Fields, which went from $1.75, and then they split them, and they came out at $178, right, per share. But, that was an amazing story, right? I remember many people said, Norm, you got to write a couple books.
No kidding.
That was one of the great, and of course, we had a quarter of a million claim staked, you know, because for me, I always hoped and dreamed of the day that a great discovery would be made, and we would gain the world's attention, and Voisey's Bay was that discovery.
Put it back on the map.
Put it on the map.
Yeah.
It put it on the map. Hope Brook put the island on the map for gold,
yeah,
and then flow-through really accelerated that. And we've had a number of gold mines, and there will be others. And then, of course, Voisey's Bay, you know, put us on the map, and Archaean, they secured not only their minerals agreement, the Labrador Minerals Agreement. I told two premiers in meetings, and one, well, he was no longer Clyde Wells, and also Brian Tobin, I said that if ever this province, as far as for resource development deals, I said, use as the template the deal that Albert and Chris and their lawyer negotiated with Robert Friedland and Jean Boulle on the Labrador Minerals Agreement, their part of the Voisey's Bay pie. And I'm not sure if they really understood what I meant, but if you go in and delve into those agreements, I mean, they're, as I say, Al Chisholm is a very astute businessman, and Chris is no slouch. I mean, they were both very solid, astute prospectors, and their lawyer, of course, was one of the best in the business. So with the 2-year management agreement, and they knew at some point, you know, that whether it was one of the large Canadian companies or international companies, well, the first thing you want to do is to remove the prospectors from the picture, manage the expectations, just like politicians. You have to try to manage the expectation. And it was a unique set of circumstances that come together, because if that was just a major that they had gotten the funding from to go to Labrador, like it was a junior, it was a chap who had a somewhat sinister, somewhat flamboyant record, Robert Friedland. I mean, he was one of the great international financiers. Several of the projects didn't go too well, but after that, well, Voisey's Bay made him a billionaire, and then he went on to Mongolia and got involved with his company Ivanhoe Minerals with the Oyu Tolgoi, the huge porphyry copper gold deposits, and what he discovered, you know, extended and really advanced those, and Rio Tinto got heavily involved there. And I remember well, a number of years before, I was the CIM Newfoundland branch president. That was back in 97 during the Cabot celebration. And so there was that. But then I was on like the technical program committee for years. So that year we were talking, looking at a speaker, right, a keynote speaker. And Voisey's Bay was just now starting to be mined. And well, they were just taking the overburden off of the ovoid. And I said, well, you know, I said, I'm going to go after Robert Friedland and try to get him for our keynote speaker. And I spent 6 months. Well, I said, Norm, you know, Friedland's not coming back here. And I said, well, let's just see. So anyway, I was at it for 6 months, right? And the old trick I learned in trouting, right? To draw in the big
fish.
So I played on his ego, right? You know, because the thing that he loves, right, that he gets a great thrill out of, it's not mining, but it's having all of these, having all of the cards in the deck in his hand, and drawing these big players, the Incos and the Falconbridges and the BHPs, and they all, because, I mean, they had discovered a world-class deposit then the Eastern Deeps they discovered. So, I mean, it was getting bigger. And so, the big nickel producing companies needed to have that asset. And so he had all of them, and then because Jackie had called me and she said, "Norm, I think," she said, "I'm going to call the book In Search of the Mother Lode, The Road to Voisey's Bay." And she's a professional, top-notch business reporter, Globe and Mail, and then she was on a number of the business shows. But she changed it and she called it The Big Score.
The Big Score.
Right? And, I remember our minister, Charles Chuck Fury, and he said to me there one day, he said, "Norman," he said, "have you read the book, The Big Score?" I said, "Oh, yes." I said, my children gave it to me for Christmas. And I said, "It's quite a story, isn't it?"
"Yeah."
"Gosh," he said, "it's just like an Indiana Jones movie." I said, "Yeah." I said, "but," I said, "Mr. Fury, there's one difference." And he said, "What's that?" I said, "This is a true story."
Yeah.
Right? And I remember at the Royal York Hotel, and we had the Atlantic Canada Rock Roll. And that was at a time, again, the industry was down, right? But is the glass half empty or is it half full? If there's one drop in the glass, there's opportunity. And so at that time, we created the Atlantic Canada Rock Rope, because you had New Brunswick here with an exhibit and several government people. You had Nova Scotia and myself. Rex Gibbons was there before he was minister. And, the numbers coming at the PDAC, they were all just crying in their beer. Mm-hmm. At the Hinko Suite or the Naranda Suite, there was just so not a lot of activity.
Yeah.
And so we went through the Royal York and we said, "Well, Bob Stairs from New Brunswick came over." He said, "Norm," he said, "I think we should try to combine." He said, "I agree with you totally." Then we went and talked to the Nova Scotia chap, and then we started. And so between the three of us, we put together what was called the Atlantic Canada Promotional Exhibit, which would have government exhibits as its anchor, but then prospector displays. And so, the Newfoundland representatives that year was a couple of years before Voisey's Bay discovery. So Albert Chisholm was there. Chris Verbisky was there with some dimension stone, several of our other prospectors in each group. And then the industry, slowly started coming back. And within a couple of years, we went from doom and gloom to a world-class discovery. Frank McKenna, we highlighted by having a premier from each of the Atlantic provinces come one year. And mm-hmm. So Premier McKenna came the first year. Okay. And the New Brunswick guys brought him over to introduce him to me. They said, "Mr. McKenna, this is one chap here you got to thank, because he was a key part of it all." And so we had a grand chat. He said, "Your name is Mercer." And I said, "Oh, yes." I said, "I've got a brother in New Brunswick." He said, "It wouldn't be Harry, would it?" He said, I said, "Oh, yes, because my brother Harry," he was the guy in new technologies with NBTEL. And Premier McKenna saw that NBTEL was a leader in, fiber optic technologies. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, we had a great chat. And McKenna, he stayed there the whole time, right? And he really pitched it. Now, then when we had Premier Wills coming through, I don't know if that was the next year, but that was, here. And then the national media, because now Clyde, he was the slayer of Meech Lake. So he brought with him, and his press secretary was Judy Foote, who just went into the Liberal cabinet, right?
Yeah.
But I remember each time when Albert would leave the room, Peter Tallman, he was with Macedon and Roser, one of the chaps, and they'd go over and they'd write on his posters, "Going for half price," because Albert was a real negotiator.
Okay.
Right? We took some prospectors to Vancouver a number of years before to the roundup when I said we accessed some funds. Al Chisholm went out there with three properties. He came back with $1.3 million in assessment commitments.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah.
His passion is to succeed.
And he does.
And he does. Yeah. Right? And what was it? Who was it? I remember there a geologist who lived in Hope, Arkansas, one March day. And he called. It was a beautiful day like this. It was cool and crisp, about 0 degrees Celsius. And this chap called Mike McMurrow. The boys call him the father of Voisey's Bay. But he was Friedland and Boole's Diamond Fields geologist, eyes and ears in North America, kind of sizing up areas as far as for diamonds or other opportunities. And somewhere, either in a journal or in a magazine or at a display, he picked up something like a geological publication on the Archean rocks of northern Labrador. And I remember the day he made the call. And he called and introduced himself. And he said, "Mr. Mercer," he said, "I'm looking at some of these areas in Labrador, and he said, you know, we're looking at, you know, diamond potential and so on. Now, around that time, we had a couple of geologists and a couple prospectors, because this was now a year or so after Fipke's discovery.
Yeah.
And Albert and Chris had asked me that spring of 1993, there was going to be, you know, because now that was the, you know, you're not selling Cadillacs, you're selling Toyotas. So PDAC, the hot button item was diamonds. So they had a big diamond workshop for all of the geologists and prospectors. So Albert and Chris called me one day and they said, Norm, we're going to drop in. We just want to have a chat about the upcoming PDAC. And I knew, like, say, as we developed the Atlantic Canada Rock Room, like, the Rita Plaskett was the PDAC manager. And so they said, Norm, there's a diamond workshop coming up prior to PDAC. Is there any way we could get into that? That's probably block full. Well, I said, let's see. So I got on the phone and I called PDA. And I said to the lady there, I said, is Rita in? Rita Plaskett? She's the manager of the convention and or for PDAC. And so anyway, so she got on. I said, Rita, I said, look, I said, I've got two aspiring, I said, prospectors sitting here in front of me. And I said, they'd really love an opportunity to be able to take in that diamond course. I said, is there any way that you can get the two of them into that free of charge, right? So anyway, she said, Norm, just give me a few minutes. So anyway, a few minutes later, back on the phone, she said, tell them to come on, uh-huh. Right? So that was in the spring of 1993. So they went to that, and they learned a number of things through that course.
That was right before the discovery?
Oh, yes, that was in the spring.
Right before.
Yeah, that was in the spring. And this geologist had come up. They sent up another geologist. And the boys had staked a couple of areas there that had some potential for copper. There was nothing staked with regards to diamonds. There had been a couple of kimberlites discovered by researchers, I think at Munn, Ken Collarson and them. There were a couple of non-diamond-bearing kimberlites discovered in the McCovey area. I think there are other opportunities there, because you'll see that noted in recommendation amongst a number of the many reports, because there was hundreds of million, you know, there was a quarter of a million claims staked over a year and a half, you know, as far as with Voices, I mean, millions of dollars changed hands with people staking claims and flipping them and so on. And there's five or six reports where either the geophysics consultant or the geological consultant refers to particular features or areas or anomalies that should be investigated for diamonds, right, in Labrador. Because as I say, you've got, you know, sandwiched in that landmass, a geological history of some 3.5 to 4 billion years, you know. So its potential is immense,
yeah.
Right? But anyway, I go on and on, forgive me.
I have one last question for you.
Did I get through the rest of them?
And that is, if you were speaking to someone much younger, like a student, for example,
yes,
what would be the one piece of advice you would give them, or the one life lesson you could give them? And it doesn't necessarily have to do with prospecting or anything like that, but regarding their career or their futures.
Well, you know, like say, we, myself and my prospecting partner, Kevin Ryan, and Peter Dimmel has come with us, and we've all just put a modest amount of money into a small private company, and we've got a couple of prospectors with us, and a couple of young geologists, and everybody's earning their interest through sweat equity. But to anyone, and like what I say to all those young, I was just out last week in the field, and I had two young geologists with me. You know, we can only give them a few dollars, but experience.
Yeah.
I only wish that back when I did geology, because when I was there, you still had that concession system as such. Those opportunities weren't there. You get field trips and so on. But to me, as far as when it comes to, if you're, you know, as far as life's lessons, life's too short. Life's too short not to pursue your dreams. And, you know, in far as pursuit of a career, it's got to be something that's that you enjoy. Mine was a passion. And that's if you have an opportunity to chase your passions and those things that you enjoy, pursue them. Don't be afraid to take a risk. Measure the best you can. For earth science students, I tell them all, I got to do a lunch and learn tomorrow. And I'll tell them, you know, get a good solid education. Get a good solid grounding in the sciences. But each and every opportunity that you have, no matter what the task, whether it's geological mapping or soil sampling or prospecting or trenching or whatever it is, all that practical, all those opportunities. And because I have a son who has a disability, for individuals today, we're all blessed with certain gifts and, nurture and pursue all those that you have and to do the best you can. That's what my parents taught me, to do one's best, be respectful of all people, and pursue your dreams.
Well, thank you.
Let's see. Forgive me.